Be available. So the slides for all three presentations today are on the website. If you go and click schedule, you'll see links next to the tutorial presentations. That's also where you'll find the recordings and the live stream. Everything will be on our website. So, yeah.
Okay, good. So, hope you had a good break. We're still on day one, so you're kind of full of energy. Okay, so Luca has the pleasure of giving you the first tutorial, right? As I said before, today we'll have three tutorials, right? So we'll have Luca's now and then after lunch, so please do come back at 1 o'clock. Then we'll have two tutorials, which is Bob and I will be giving those tutorials. And the main emphasis today is on closing the sense act loop, because classically, right, what happens is that those of us who like to do research in planning, motion, or task planning, we put all our energy into planning, but we don't care about actually how they operate on real robots, right? So what I want you to do is to understand the importance of embedding yourself in terms of a sense act loop. Also, you know, in deference to Rod Books, there's a lot of decision making that you can do which isn't planning in terms of doing that effectively and robustly. Now, our ability to act in the world is rooted in our perception, and hence that's why we're starting with Luca, right? Who will be giving you a tutorial that kind of more deeply understand perception. We could have a whole summer school on perception, and that's not what we're doing here. So Luca has the challenge, right, of giving you both the fundamentals and the cool stuff in an hour and a half.
That's a nice challenge. Probably compress around 30 years of research in robotics in 1 hour and a half. I'll do my best. Okay. Good morning, guys. So welcome to the tutorial on spatial perception for robotics. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'm very excited about the summer school. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Luca Carlone. I'm assistant professor at MIT, and I'm the director of the Spark Lab. Spark stands for Sensing, Perception, and Autonomy for Robot Kinetics Lab. So why they invited me to work to give like this tutorial on perception? Well, I've been working in perception for the last 10 years, I would say. I'm very fascinated about problems in word understanding and 3D reconstruction for robotics. This is just an example of some recent work we did on 3D mapping using like camera and inertial measurement unit. And during the years, I implemented this kind of technology on several platforms, from like small drones to self-driving cars, airplanes, helmets, and so on. So a lot of experience there. I've been also fascinated by the mathematical aspects of perception and the problem of simultaneous localization and mapping. I will tell you more about that, and the theoretical underpinning of simultaneous localization and mapping, as well as real implementation with single and multi-robot system. Here I'm showing some collaboration with the Army Research Lab we did a couple of years ago. The thing that is exciting about perception, about spatial perception in general, is that this research that we are doing is getting more and more mature and is transitioning to real products quite fast recently. So this, for example, is a drone which is called the SkyDio R1, and it's using for perception and for localization a library which is called GTSM, which is something developed by Frank Dellert at Georgia Tech, and is a library I've been contributing to a few years ago. So what you're seeing there is the drone following the lady here, and everything is fully autonomous without control of the drone. Everything is autonomous. Cool. So the plan for today is to tell you more about spatial perception, in particular focusing on simultaneous localization and mapping and visual inertial navigation. And the goal that I want to have is threefold. So first of all, for those of you who are not working in this area and just want to learn more, I will give a broad overview of the area and a little bit of understanding, a little bit of like information about the algorithms using spatial perception. For those of you who are interested in using these technologies without worrying too much about the algorithms, I'm providing several pointers to open source implementation that you can just use. They are online, they are good implementation, they are pretty much plug and play. And finally, for those of you who are doing active research on SLAM, for example, or on spatial perception, I will conclude this presentation with a list, short list of open problems. So like where we are headed to in terms of the research on spatial perception, what is the future of spatial perception. So we start with a little bit of definition of what is perception and the word models. What I want to say is that please feel free to just interrupt me at any point, okay? I want to keep this like as interactive as I can. So here we start with basic definition. You know, of course, what is sensing. Sensing is about measuring physical stimuli from the environment. The first taxonomy that I want to do is the difference between proprioceptive and exteroceptive sensors. So proprioceptive sensors are measuring internal states of the robot. For example, probably the most popular one is our wheel encoders, which are measuring the rotation at the wheels of the robot. Same applies to the robotic arms, in which wheel encoders, or like motor encoders, are used to measure rotation at the joints of the robot. Finally, another popular proprioceptive sensor is the inertial measurement unit, which is measuring acceleration and rotation rates of the robot. On the other end, we have exteroceptive sensors. Exteroceptive sensors are measuring external quantities to the robots, are measuring something about the external environment. Probably the most popular in the 2000 and so on, the most popular exteroceptive sensor was the LIDAR, the 2D LIDAR, which is measuring on a plane the distances to obstacles, like on the horizontal plane. Of course, there is a 3D version. Other sensors that I will mention are cameras, very, very popular right now for robot perception. And in early years, there was a lot of work on cheaper sensors, I would say, like ultrasonic and infrared. So this is about sensing, just the terminology. You may be familiar with this, in which case, like, we move fast to the perception part. What is the difference between perception and sensing? Perception is, by definition, the awareness of the elements of the environment through physical sensation. That's like the dictionary definition. Let me give you my definition. The robotic definition of perception is the use of sensor data and prior knowledge to create a coherent internal model of the external world to be used by a robot, okay? This is the same, you can apply pretty much the same definition to human perception, but in this case, we're interested in computational or machine or robot perception, okay? I really like the image of like perception being about the robot observing the real world by using sensor and then using like perception, which is both like hardware and algorithms to process the sensor data and building an internal model of the world. So what are the typical things we care about in spatial perception? So first of all, we typically want to reconstruct a map of the environment. We want to see like what are the free space. This is a top view of the environment to see what are the free space and what are the obstacles in the environment. This is what is called the mapping part of spatial perception. The second portion is about figuring out where the robot is in the environment. Estimating the pose of the robot is called typically localization. How many of you know what is a pose? Somebody wants to define a pose? What is a pose? Yeah, so it's a rotation essentially plus a position. It's the description of where the robot is, X, Y, Z, plus the attitude of the robot. Okay. And then of course, like besides estimating the map and the pose of the robot, you typically want to estimate, you may want to estimate the pose of other objects or other robots or people in the environment. So this is what is called object detection and tracking. Of course, you know, depending on the application that you have to do, you may want to build like a map of the temperature of the room, like any other quantity. So the task for perception really depends on the task that you have to do. What perception has to provide depends on the task that you have to complete. So why do we need spatial perception at all? Well, I can give you like few task examples in which it's clear that we need this kind of like mapping and localization infrastructure. The simplest one is the case in which the task for the robot is to move from point A to point B. In this case, spatial perception has to provide the current location of the robot, which is A, and that's the localization part. And it has to provide the position of B in the same reference frame of A, and also like a possible trajectory that reaches B without colliding. For that, you clearly need a map of the environment. And I can do several examples on why you need spatial perception to support task execution in a number of tasks. Can you imagine that if the task is about picking an object, the detection and tracking of the object is crucial like to complete the task. If the task is about meeting another robot, the spatial perception, understanding of the map, and the position of the other robot is crucial. So let me complete this overview and the taxonomy of perception by talking about word models. We said that the goal of perception is to build a representation of the world to be used by the robot, and in particular, we are going to build maps of the world. Here, I want to tell you a little bit more about what are the typical maps that are used in robotics. First of all, what is a map? So a map is a collection of elements, which are landmarks, relevant places, and possibly a representation of the connection among these places. If you think about Google Maps, on Google Maps, you always see like position of landmarks you may care about, and also the white lanes, of course, express connectivity among these places. So, of course, there are desirable properties that you want your maps to have, in particular for robotics. So, of course, the map should describe obstacles in the environment. You typically want to use this map for navigation. You should be able to do computation on this map, so they should be easy to perform computation on and should be scalable. You really want to like estimate large-scale maps of the environment. So, similarly to humans, robots typically use very different maps for different tasks. So let me tell you like a little bit more about what are the typical maps here. So the first type of map is what is called a landmark-based map. Landmark-based map is simply like a collection of distinguishable landmarks in the environment expressed in a common reference frame. So you can imagine that for a human, like, you know, this is a map of Paris, I think. There are a bunch of landmarks which are distinguishable. For a robot, for example, moving in indoor environment, the distinguishable elements can be like the corners of the room, or in a self-driving car problem can be the different like traffic signs, for example. When I talk about landmarks, you do not have necessarily to attach a semantic meaning to the landmark. In particular, like in vision-based application, landmarks can be just points that you observe in the image, which you can reliably redetect in consecutive images. So you should not, for example, like, you know, these kind of corners that you see, should see in yellow, I would say, do not necessarily have like semantic meaning. So what is the good thing about using landmark-based map? Essentially, these are just a list of landmarks, are very like easy to store, and they scale very well to very large maps. The disadvantage is that if I store just landmarks, a landmark representation of the world, I have no idea about obstacles, right? So I don't know really how to get from point A to point B without hitting obstacles. The second type of representation, I'm still talking about the 2D and then I will generalize to 3D, is representing a map as a collection of points, segments, or polygons. You can imagine that if I have like a 2D laser scanner, I can estimate a bunch of points corresponding to where the laser is hitting like obstacles, and I can just estimate a 2D point cloud of the environment. If I want to be more fancy, instead of using points, I use segments, so I try to build a segment map of the environment, or I can also go to like 2D polygons representing obstacles in the environment. Again, this is a representation in which you just have to list a bunch of geometric primitives. It's a very lightweight representation and scales very well. Disadvantage is that of course, you are not able to really express all types of environment in terms of, for example, lines or polygons. For example, if you have an environment like this, you may still fit lines maybe to the trees and so on, but really does not play well with these geometric primitives. Now we get probably to the most popular representation for maps in robotics, at least in the 2D case, which is the notion of an occupancy grid map. How many of you know what is an occupancy grid map? I just want to... Okay, good amount, not everybody. So an occupancy grid map is a discretization of the environment in which the robot moves. You have to imagine that you're looking at the environment from a top view, and the environment is discretized in cells. For each cell, you are assigning a number, which is the probability of that cell being occupied. So if the probability is zero, the cell is free for sure, and is shown in white here in the map. If the cell is has probability of occupation one, then it's shown in black, for sure is an obstacle, and other things which are probability of occupation 0.5 or so are essentially location in the map for which you don't know if there is an obstacle there or not. So the advantage here is that we are trying to capture, first of all, we have like a probabilistic representation, which is great because we will have like uncertainty about sensor readings, so we have uncertainty pretty much everywhere in robotics. Moreover, the map intrinsically is capturing information about obstacles. So we know that, for example, you know, this is an obstacle and we cannot like plan over the obstacle, we have to go around it and so on. The disadvantage is that right now we have a discretization of an environment in which you have to store values for each cell, values, probabilities, occupation for each cell. You can think about this as a 2D image, so possibly you have to store a very large image, which is typically not a big deal, but still you have like a different scalability with respect to the previous representation we discussed about. So, of course, there is a trade-off in terms of resolution, which discretizes the environment, and memory and computational cost of managing this representation. All this representation we are discussing right now for the 2D case as an example will essentially extend to the 3D case. So for example, the case in which you represent the environment in terms of a collection of points, segments, or polygons will extend directly to the 3D case. You will have like 3D point clouds from a 3D LiDAR, for example. You can have a map of points and segments, or you can have a map of polygons, like, you know, a mesh, for example, triangular polygonal mesh. Similarly, the very popular representation that I mentioned, which is the occupancy grid map, will generalize to the case in which instead of having like 2D pixels, 2D cells, which are discretizing the environment, you consider a 3D discretization in what are called voxels. So you just discretize the environment in X, Y, Z. Okay? In this case, you start thinking that here you should start worrying about computational cost because these representations are typically very large in terms of memory and computational cost. So far, I told you like a couple of things. I told you that in spatial perception, typically you care about localizing the robot, mapping the environment, potentially like tracking other objects. And also I described a number of like potential map representation that you can use to describe the environment in which the robot is moving in. The second part of this presentation is going to touch on algorithms that you can use to create a map of the environment. So we'll touch on SLAM, which is simultaneous localization and mapping, and a variant which is called visual inertial odometry. And I will try to get a little bit more into the algorithms used for SLAM. I will give an example of open source implementation, and I will give you like example of recent work as well as application, for example, in industry. The final part of the presentation is about discussing open problems related to spatial perception and SLAM. Do you have questions so far? Okay, very basic stuff so far. Definition, I'm pretty sure you guys are very familiar with most of the definition I gave, but I want to make sure that we have the same terminology so far. So, as I mentioned, there are different variants of the problem, of the spatial perception problem, and I want to formalize what are the three main variants, which are localization, mapping, and SLAM. So the localization problem is about, I give you a map of the environment, for example, an occupancy grid map of the environment, and I give you like sensor data acquired by the robot. Then the localization problem is, given the map and the sensor data, the problem of estimating the pose, the current pose of the robot with respect to the map. The second problem is mapping. In this case, pure mapping is about, I give you the trajectory of the robot over time, from time zero to the final time, and I give you all the sensor measurements that the robot is acquiring over time. And the mapping problem is about, giving these two pieces of data, estimate, build a map of the environment. What we are going to discuss today is a combination of both things. So you have a little bit less prior knowledge. So the robot has to start navigating in some environment without pretty much any prior knowledge about the environment itself. So you don't know the trajectory, you don't know the map of the environment, and the simultaneous localization and mapping problem is about using the sensor data to build a map of the environment and at the same time estimate the trajectory of the robot moving in the environment. So I will focus today mainly on the SLAM problem. What I want to tell you is, essentially, I want to start as a motivation with the mapping problem, which to me is like a much simpler problem to deal with. In particular, let's start considering the mapping problem, which you have a robot, for example, a drone, moving like in this environment. And as I said, in the mapping problem, you assume that you know the trajectory, exactly the trajectory of the robot, okay? Moreover, you assume that you have the sensor data. So for instance, here, assume that the robot is equipped with the 2D LiDAR, okay? At time zero, this is the local measurement from the 2D LiDAR. At time one, this is the local measurement. Everything is expressed in the local frame of the robot. So at this point in mapping, if you assume that you know the trajectory of the robot, building a globally consistent map is pretty easy. You just have, you know exactly where this pose is in a global reference frame, where each of these poses is in a reference frame. You just have to rototranslate all these poses, all this sensor data in a consistent map, which is easy as long as you know where is the, you know, where are all these poses in a global reference frame. So mapping is an easy problem. We can also, if we don't want to look at this segment map, we can account for uncertainty and build an occupancy grid map by using like this probabilistic model, which is you know, the probabilistic occupancy map. What we want to solve today is a much more challenging problem, which is SLAM. I want to tell you like the work done in SLAM over the last few years. So the inputs to SLAM are, as I said, is the sensor data. We mentioned that there are two types of sensors that we typically use in SLAM. One are the proprioceptive sensor, and the other one are the exteroceptive sensor. And you move in a completely unknown environment. The output of SLAM is a map of the environment as well as a trajectory of the robot in the same reference frame of the map. Okay, so from sensor data to a world model. This is a chicken and egg problem simply because, as I said, if you are given the trajectory of the robot, just reconstructing the map is very easy. That's the previous slide. And at the same time, if I give you the map of the environment, solving the localization problem is quite easy. It's, you know, not as easy as mapping, but it's quite easy. Okay, so let's try to understand how to attack SLAM. And as I said, if you're given the trajectory of the robot, mapping is easy. So let's try to find like an easy way to figure out what is the trajectory of the robot. The first attempt is about doing motion integration. So you have like proprioceptive sensors, and proprioceptive sensors typically estimate the change in the state of the robot, for example, acceleration, rotations, or wheel odometry, which are telling you like how the robot moves over time, the change in the internal state of the robot. So the first attempt to attack SLAM is by using odometry. So we start at a non-pose. For example, we initialize the initial pose to be the 0, 0, 0, the initial pose. And then we integrate the control or the proprioceptive measurements to estimate the current trajectory, the trajectory of the robot over time. So in practice, you know, the robot starts at some pose 0. We measure the rotation of the wheels. And by using this information about the rotation of the wheel, we try to estimate how the robot moves at time 1, 2, and so on, and reconstruct the entire trajectory. Similarly, here at the bottom plot, I'm showing like the case in which you have an IMU, which is measuring acceleration. You may think to get an estimate of the trajectory of the robot by integrating the acceleration to velocity and then velocity to position. For example, you get the position of the robot at all times. Now, my question for you is, what is the issue with this kind of approach? So this is like a very naive way to attack the problem, which is called odometry, just integrating motion. What do you think is the problem with this approach? Bless you. So basic idea is that if you have a little bit of noise on the sensor data, already the process of integration is making like constant noise into a ramp, into a quadratically increasing noise. So the, essentially like after the double integration process in this case, you have a quick accumulation of noise, which according to what your colleague said, will lead to accumulation of error. So what you will see is that essentially your estimate of the trajectory will diverge with respect to the ground truth trajectory. So in odometry, essentially the basic idea is that you always have this increase of error over time, this drift. And we can see also like in a real example, like in a simulated example, what is the implication of like this noise accumulation. So here you see an example in which there is the ground truth simulated robot. So that's the actual map and the actual pose of the robot. And this is mapping from the odometric estimate. So I build the trajectory by integrating the motion of the robot, and I try to reconstruct the map using this trajectory. So you should start seeing that slowly over time, essentially, the trajectory is diverging. And indeed, instead of reconstructing this corridor in a nice way, the divergence is causing, like, you know, the corridor to seem like, you know, like two different corridors. And if you keep going, this will drift more and more. Yeah, so in many cases in perception, that's like also an interesting thing. Like you assume the control to be given, so you really, in several cases, you can think that this is teleoperation or like there is a controller or planner going on, okay? Later I will talk about using like this kind of estimates to close the loop over control, but here, for example, was teleoperation. So, of course, you know, the basic like motion integration here was kind of a naive approach. So the map will look bad at the end. So it means that, for example, the robot may be very confident about, I don't know, traversing this area in which there is an obstacle instead. So this kind of map is bad for navigation. So the first lesson we learned so far is that we really have to model uncertainty. We said that there is noise in the sensor data. We really have to model that. So uncertainty is omnipresent in robot perception, and we need to model it. So before, I was one part that I didn't discuss too much is that for the sake of odometry, to reconstruct an odometric estimate, an odometric trajectory, you can either rely on sensors like IMU, for example, measuring acceleration and so on, but you can also rely on some dynamics, non-dynamics of the robot, okay? So for example, you can reconstruct the odometric estimate by just integrating the dynamics. For example, these are the dynamics of Hackerman, you know, of a car, essentially. And here you see that I can estimate the velocity of an x, y, and theta. That's like a 2D problem. By knowing the delta, which is the steering angle, and the linear velocity, which is v. So these are the inputs to the control. I can integrate these, and I can obtain like the trend over time of x, y, and theta. Okay, that's like another way to get the odometric estimate. So I said that this is not enough because truly, you know, the dynamics, the theoretical dynamics that I'm using are not faithful to the actual thing because of noise. So there is noise in practice, and this deterministic model will not do it, will not like model properly the noise. So what I do right now is to try to estimate the stochastic nature of the noise, try to include the noise here in the modeling. To do that, I just use a little bit of notation. For example, I write the XR, which is the state of the robot, XRK, which is the state of the robot at time K. And in 2D case, these include the XY position of the robot and the theta, which is the orientation of the robot. Also, like instead of using like a continuous time version of the dynamics, I can use like a discrete time version, saying that, for example, the state at time k minus 1 compounded with the control action u gives the state at time k. So in other words, this, which is called the motion model, tells me how the state of the robot evolves from time k minus 1 to time k, depending on the control action I apply. So one thing that I want to remark is that in this presentation, the notion of control and proprioceptive measurement will be really identical. We really don't care about you know, the u being control or like a proprioceptive measurement. So if I take a control theoretic perspective, the control action that I applied here is the u and influence the way my state evolved from time k minus 1 to time k. But I can also think that, for example, the u is a measurement of the acceleration from the accelerometer at time k minus 1. And in this case, my measurement of the acceleration tells me how I move from state k minus 1 to state k. Okay? So for this presentation, I will typically use the term proprioceptive measurement, control, and even odometry in the same way. OK, so far we said we have to capture the uncertainty which is present in the sensor data. So this very basic model, which is deterministic, will not be sufficient. So we have to transition from this kind of model to we have to transition to a model capturing essentially the noise. So you can see that I'm transitioning from this deterministic model to a stochastic model which is identical except for the fact that I also have an error term epsilon, okay? So including the noise as part of the model. This again is called the motion model. You can think that the noise is due to the things that I simply don't model in my mathematical formula. Is due to unexpected events like wheel slip or gear backlash, measurement noise from encoders, quantization error, all type of errors are captured by this epsilon. There are very different ways to model this noise. In this presentation, what is done mostly in perception is to assume that the noise is random in nature. So you have like a random variables, random variable epsilon here. Again, like, you know, this is the state of the robot at time k minus one. This is the state of the robot at time k. The u is either the control action or the proprioceptive measurement, and the epsilon u is the corresponding noise. Okay, we said that if I just integrate this kind of model, since I don't know the noise, this will diverge over time. So let's see what is the next best thing we can do. So it's worth mentioning that odometry, the word odometry in robotics has like a very long history. Actually, it was known as dead reckoning in, for example, aircraft navigation, and was a technique used for like maritime navigation like in early times, and of course is known to accumulate error over time. Is not the error accumulation and the drift in odometry is not like something specific to robotics. Also for human navigation, if you just close your eyes and you try like to move after some time, essentially your estimate or where you are will diverge from your current position or where you are. There is like a popular example, for example, is known that a human is not able to walk along a straight line if he is blindfolded walking in a desert, so without like any external reference. So typically, like if you blindfold a person, they will keep walking in circles. So purely odometric estimate based on proprioceptive sensor will drift over time. Of course, the best thing that we can do at this point is to include more information. We do not have just proprioceptive sensor, we also have other sensor data. So the basic intuition behind SLAM is that we must use an external source of information. We must use exteroceptive sensor to localize the robot with respect to external structure, external landmarks in the environment. That's why I was making the example of the desert in which you really like, you know, do not have like anything to localize with respect to. So the intuition now is that if you combine data from proprioceptive sensor, essentially your estimate of your own motion, with data from exteroceptive sensor that are telling you information about the external world, you should be able to bound the accumulation of error. You should be able to estimate your trajectory as well as the map. Okay, so we have this mathematical equation which is telling the evolution of the state of the robot from time k minus one to time k. So we are able to model mathematically the odometry. We just want to spend one slide or like few slides on modeling the exteroceptive sensor data. We really need mathematical model to really be able to do estimation or perception. So assume that we are able to recognize landmarks, this static structure in the environment. The problem is now, how do we model mathematically an observation of a landmark in the environment? Well, it turns out that the answer is that it depends really on what you measure about the landmark. You can measure the distance to the landmark, you can measure like the bearing, the angle to the landmark, you can measure different quantities. For example, if you measure the distance, it's pretty clear that if you're observing a landmark Li, with respect to your pose, the pose of the robot, which is XR at time K, the distance will be like, you know, some square root, you know, essentially the Euclidean distance between the landmark and the robot pose, plus some noise. Another popular, so this is a bearing distance measurement that typically you get when using LiDAR sensor, like, you know, range measurements. Or for example, you can measure the bearing of the landmark with respect to the robot, which is essentially the angle at which you see the landmark in the reference frame of the robot, which is given by this expression, of course. So just some notation, the Z is the measurement, so it's what you get from the sensor, and you are writing the sensor measurement as a function of the unknown state of the landmark and of the robot, plus some noise. Okay. So in general, the way you measure exteroceptive sensor is by saying, I have a mathematical relation telling me how the measurement is function of the state that I want to estimate. In this case, for example, the state of the robot and the state of the landmark plus potentially some noise. So in this case, I start without any prior knowledge about the environment. So I don't know the pose of the robot and I don't know the position of the landmark. I have to estimate both at the same time just by knowing the exteroceptive measurement and the proprioceptive measurement. That's the only input to the problem. So we are getting to a nice point in which I'm modeling mathematically the input data that I have to the problem. And once I have a mathematical model, I have to figure out how to solve, how to estimate the quantities that I care about. So as I just wrote on the whiteboard, while the expression of what is called measurement model, which is the way you model mathematically the exteroceptive measurements, really depends on the quantity that you measure. A very general expression that you can use is that the exteroceptive measurement is some function of known function of the state of the robot and the state of standing external, some external landmark in the environment, and potentially some measurement noise. That's an excellent point. So the way you choose the landmarks, landmarks by definition are just distinguishable points in the environment. The way you choose the landmarks depends on the sensor that you use. If you use vision, for example, which is fairly popular sensor for robotics, you can have like very high level landmarks like objects. You can have an object detector detecting, for example, a chair and so on. And you can have also very low level landmarks, for example, visual features. In an image, if you do like corner detection, you can detect distinguishable points in the environment, and you can attach a descriptor to each of these points, and you can use them as landmarks. The assumption, I was going to get to that point like in 2 seconds, is that all these are static. So, you want to identify structure in the environment is not moving over time. And that's pretty much intuitively is what happens for human as well. You typically don't use for navigation like the position of another person, but use static things in the building, for example. Okay, so we are able to measure, to model mathematically like proprioceptive measurement, exteroceptive measurements. The thing that I don't really like here is that we can write these models in a little bit of a more compact form. I want essentially, what I'm going to do in the next slide is to put together all the things that I have to estimate in a single vector. That's just to make the derivation a little bit more elegant. It's not a big deal. But the basic idea is that in SLAM, you don't know anything about the environment. You don't know anything about the robot. So you have to estimate at the same time the pose of the robot over time and the position of these landmarks in the environment. So to make things a little bit more elegant, what we do is that we have the pose of the robot that we want to estimate, we have the landmark position that we want to estimate, we just stack everything in a single big vector. Consider that in the previous slide I was doing an example with a single landmark, but in real problems you will have a large number of landmarks that you observe in the world. So in this case you have M landmarks and the robot pose, and this is the vector that you really want to estimate in SLAM. Question for you, what is the size of this vector? Just to visualize a little bit better what you're talking about. In a 2D problem, what is the size of this vector? 2m plus 3. Okay, because each landmark is like a position xy, so two variables for each landmark. We have m landmarks and three variables defining robot position. And it's easy to get to 3m plus 6 for the for the 3D case in which each landmark is like a 3D point. So another insight here is that that's the vector we want to estimate. But the observation is that we want to estimate this vector from noisy measurements. So all both models that we wrote on the whiteboard include some measurement noise term. So the epsilon is a random variable. So in general, you do not expect to be able to estimate exactly the state of the robot. You will always have some uncertainty around your estimate. And this is why over the last 10 years has been like a huge development of what is called probabilistic robotics, in which you essentially face this state estimation problem under a probabilistic perspective. And what you do, rather than just trying to compute the exact value of the robot state, which is impossible, you try to recover a probability distribution. So this is very important. Rather than estimating exactly the state of the robot and the landmarks, you try to reason in terms of the probability distribution over the state of the robot and the landmarks given U, which is the set of proprioceptive measurements from the beginning of time 1 to the current time k, and Z, which is a set of exteroceptive measurements from time 1 to time k. So you want to reason again over the probability distribution over the state, the slump state, given all the previous information that the robot collected. This is what is called the belief, okay? So imagine that, again, if the slump state here is a vector of 2m plus 3 and so on, this probability distribution will be defined over like a large state space, a probability distribution in a 2m plus 3 dimensional world. So, yeah. Yeah, I'll touch a little bit on that part. I would say that it's typically multimodal, but the better answer is that really depends on the type of sensor data. What happens typically is that if you have very accurate sensors, it's very intuitive, right? If you have very accurate sensor, we'll define pretty well what is the peak of this distribution. The more you have ambiguity in the sensor data, the more this distribution will start being messy. And indeed, what you're going to do in the following slide is that for some problem it's actually fair to approximate this distribution with a Gaussian. We'll get there. But in general it's a very complicated distribution. And again, I'm showing like a 2D distribution, but it actually lives in a very large space. It's just a toy representation. All right. Yeah. Yeah, so that's like a very important problem. I will touch on that also in the open problem part. This is what is called data association. It's a very fundamental problem because it turns out that problem is actually more important and somehow less solved than a bunch of things I'm describing. Here I'm describing like really the basic infrastructure for estimation, but that's like a very fundamental problem for real robotic application. To tell you like in a different way, the concern from your colleague is for example, if I have a measurement ZK, let's say like a pixel measurement in an image, how do I say if that measurement corresponds to landmark I or landmark J? Right? How do I do the association between the measurement and the landmark? Or another example, if I'm doing like my landmarks are objects, if I use chairs as different objects, how do I understand if I'm measurement chair number 1 or chair number 2? Okay. This is what is called data association problem, and I will mention that several times, also like talking about limitation of the current techniques. Data association, okay. So, yeah.
Push on the belief on the previous slide. Is it not conditioned on either the previous state or the initial state?
Not on the previous state, but on the initial state. So here on the right-hand side, we find that typically that's the definition of the belief you will find, for example, in probabilistic robotics. You may have or not prior knowledge about the initial state. The truth is that in SLAM, since you don't know anything, you set the initial state to be, you know, position 0, essentially. So that's why you typically just forget about that. And you don't condition on the previous state. The conditioning on the previous state will emerge on, from the equation that we use to estimate that, but that's what you want to get. That's what essentially is estimating what is the state of the world and of the robot given all the data that we have seen so far. So the exercise that we are doing here, just to go back to this slide, we're trying to get a little bit of a more elegant vector formulation in which we stack all the unknown in a single vector. So in the following slide, we continue this exercise by rewriting these two expressions as a function of the larger vector, the SLAM state. To do that, we start from the motion model. So we want to rewrite, instead of like a motion model with respect to the state of the robot, we want to rewrite that the motion model with respect to the SLAM state, which is again like, you know, robot state and the landmass. So at this point, I'm arguing that the equation, the motion model of the SLAM state can be written like this. In which the equation again is telling me the state, the SLAM state at time k with respect to the SLAM state at time k minus 1. So do you guys have any guess about why the landmarks do not undergo any transformation? Okay, the landmarks are static, right? So they are not moving, so their position will remain the same between time k minus 1 and k. Instead, the robot is moving, so essentially the dynamics of the robot are the same we wrote on the whiteboard before. We are just stacking all the equations that we have in a single big motion model that can be written in compact form, again, as a function which is transforming the state at previous time in the state at current time, given the odometric information and the noise, or like, you know, modeling the noise as well. For the measurement model, we can do the same. The measurement model is involving a couple of variables, but right now they are both included in this large vector, so we can rewrite any measurement model pretty much, saying that the measurements, the extraceptive measurement that we get, is a non-function of the SLAM state, potentially like plus noise. You know, that's what you said. One thing that is actually good to do, like at least for to bridge with the next part of the presentation, is to realize that writing this process, this motion model and the measurement model are somehow like one way to approach the problem by writing like analytic expression, the evolution of the state and of the measurements. Another complementary but equivalent view is to think about these and these in terms of probability distributions. So for example, we can think that this function telling us the motion model from time k minus 1 to time k is equivalent to telling a probability distribution of the current state given the previous state and the command. Okay. So let's do maybe an example about that. Just let's try. So we can say, for example, that this is the motion model. Let's put the U as well. And that's the noise. And we can say that the noise, for example, is a normal distribution, is a random variable distributed according to a normal distribution with some covariance sigma. Then what you can do is that if this is essentially a sum of the state at the previous time plus the control plus epsilon, you can say that essentially xk is distributed according to a normal distribution with mean a xk minus 1 plus u and covariance epsilon, sigma, sorry. So that's just noise propagation from this equation to this. But essentially, I'm showing that either you can write these in terms of a motion model, or you can write these as a probability distribution. Not super crucial, but right now, I hope I convince you that you can write any formula like this in terms of a probability distribution, and you can do the same in terms of the measurement model. You can write this expression telling you what is the measurement with respect to the state as the probability of the state of the measurement given the state. So this is called transition probability, typically, and this is called measurement likelihood. So we'll need these two interpretations because actually will allow us to introduce a little bit, give an easier introduction to the algorithms that we use to estimate this probability distribution, to estimate the slump state, which is the part that I'm going to cover next. So do you guys have questions so far? So I guess that the slump state should be clear. The idea of estimating probabilities of the slump state are clear. Are you guys clear about the motion model, measurement model, and the probabilistic interpretation? Okay. Yeah. So are you referring to this or to the definition of the belief? So in the belief, there are U and Z, because what you want to do is you want to infer some state or some vector given all the data that you have. And you have to imagine that the U and the Z are simply two different measurements, right? One is from, for example, the IMU, and one is from the camera. So you want to include both of them. And the fact that the noise on these measurements is typically independent because they are different sensors means that the more measurement you include, the better will be your estimate. So you do need to include that. Does it make sense? So you can treat U as an input or as a proprioceptive measurement. It's pretty much identical. If you treat it as an input, essentially you're saying that you apply a nominal input, but your system will be noisy, so we'll do like slightly different than what you expect, and that's the noise. But again, the input and the measurements are two sources of information that you want to use, so you cannot get rid. You don't want to get rid of any of those. Okay, so we have pretty much everything in place. If you think so far, what we really did, we stated the problem and gave a little bit of terminology about the problem itself. And then we laid out like a mathematical formulation for the input data, because the measurement model and the motion model are essentially a way to model the input data. I haven't told you anything about how to solve the problem. That's like what we are going to cover next. So the way to solve this problem is, of course, something that has been like argument of the literature for the last 30 years. And for your convenience, I'm putting a little bit of a timeline that will populate going through the slides. So this timeline essentially is showing popularity of the approach over the years, starting from 1990. I would say that very early work on SLAM was 1985, 1987. And the very first formulation of the SLAM, the very first grounded formulation of SLAM, was by using what is called the extended Kalman filter SLAM. This has been pioneered by a few people, including John Leonard, who is professor here at MIT and McKee. So these are papers of the late 80s. So let's go through I'm going to talk about two different formulations. The first one will be EKF SLAM, and I will be able to use pretty much whatever we said so far about the mathematical modeling. So let's look at EKF SLAM. So the basic tool that we use in EKF SLAM is something that is called Bayes filter. If you don't know, how many of you know about the Bayes filter? Okay. So if you don't know about the Bayes filter, my message here is that this is not just a tool for SLAM, it's like a very general tool for estimation. In the case in which you want to estimate some variable you don't know, so it's a very handy tool to know about. Bayes filter is essentially, in the case of SLAM, is a grounded formulation to combine proprioceptive measurements and exteroceptive measurements, so combine different sources of data. It's a general solution to many estimation problems. And is about computing exactly the belief. So what the Bayes filter is trying to do is to estimate this large probability distribution over time. So the picture that you should have about the Bayes filter is that you start at time, let's say you start at time zero. So you start with the belief at time zero, in which the belief is about, you know, the what you know about the state of the world given the measurements that you've taken so far. And the Bayes filter will do some magic to include the proprioceptive measurement, the exteroceptive measurements, and produce the belief at the current time given the belief at the previous time. So the filter will work as follows. You know something at time k minus one. You take new measurement from the anion, let's say proprioceptive measurements. You take new measurement from the camera, let's say exteroceptive measurements. And the Bayes filter will include this information, these new measurements, into your belief to estimate the new belief at time k. Okay? It's a recursive formulation, so you have to apply this filter at every single time. And the filter is transforming what you think about the world and the robot state at time k minus one, and it's transforming that into what the robot believes about the world and the robot itself at time k. So not the difference, you know, the difference here is just an index, right? You're just moving one step farther what you believe about the world. Let's look now at the mathematics of this. That's like, you know, the nice picture is the intuition. That's the actual implementation of the Bayes filter. The Bayes filter works in two stages, in two steps. One is called the prediction step, and the other one is called the update step. The prediction step is very intuitive. The prediction step will include the proprioceptive data, and the update step will include the exteroceptive data. So you include these two sources of information in two different steps, which is nice. Here, while I will not have time to prove why the expression of the Bayes filter is like that, I want to tell you that the Bayes filter is the Bayes filter is the result of a very simple, very basic probability rules. So let me give you a little bit of the intuition. So the first equation will follow from a very basic law of total probability. So if you want to compute, if you have two random variables, A and B, which for example can be x of k and x of k minus 1, the probability of A is equal to the integral of the joint probability A and B, dB. You guys don't see it? You see it? Which is the same as saying, so I can decompose these probabilities, P of A given B multiplied P of B, dB. While this is not a proof, you can see that the expression of this guy really looks like the expression that you have over there. You have an integral, you have a conditional probability, which is the first one, and you have the other belief, which is this one, and that is the integration. Okay, that's just hand-wavy way to say that the Bayes filter is actually something that is based on very basic probability rules. There is nothing fancy going on here. So let's focus a little bit on the prediction. The prediction is doing this integral, which is taking the belief at time k minus one, is multiplying that by the motion model. So essentially it's including how the robot believes is moving according to the odometry, and is integrating to obtain the belief at time k, given the proprioceptive data, but before adding the exteroceptive data. You can see that the index is still k minus one on the z, on the exteroceptive data. The update will take this belief, will just multiply by the measurement likelihood, or the measurement model if you want, it will give the posterior belief, which is the belief at time k, given all the proprioceptive and exteroceptive measurements till that time. Questions? So you guys being lost, yeah. Yeah, so a couple of questions. Let's assume for a moment that at least they're synchronized. So you have like odometry, and then camera. At least they're synchronized. You can apply multiple prediction steps, and then you just update where you get the camera. If they're not synchronized, you have to synchronize them. Other questions? Yeah.
Is alpha just for normalization?
Yeah, so alpha is just normalizing everything to be probability, which means that to integrate to one.
Okay.
but typically you don't care about the alpha, you don't even care about estimating that. So quite excited to see, you know, we have like this very general problem in which you have like probability distribution, we want to estimate this very high dimensional belief. And I told you that the Bayes filter is solving it all. It's solving like every problem like that. And it's like a very simple formula which is solving exactly the problem, the SLAM problem at several other estimation problems. Should be happy. The issue with this is that in general, this formulation is intractable, okay? There's a very, you know, easy way to see that there is an integral of something that lives in a very high dimension. So you cannot, and these are like, you know, non-linear stuff and so on. So this integral cannot be computed in general. And solving that integral is intractable. You cannot hope to solve that integral exactly for arbitrary distribution. Another way to say that, you saw that this distribution that I was plotting like in the previous slide are very regular. For arbitrary distribution, there is no hope to do that integration. So this brings us to the Kalman filter and then to the extended Kalman filter that we are going to use for SLAM. It turns out that in very special cases, the Bayes filter has a closed form solution that can be computed easily. What is this special case? Well, not surprising, the fact that the special case is the case in which the system, both for the measurement model, for the measurement model, for the motion model, in this special case must be linear. So instead of generic nonlinear F and H, we should just have like linear expression telling the evolution of the state, you know, with respect to perceptive measurements and noise, and the same for the measurement. So after the linearity assumption, and assuming that the noise on the measurements, on the motion, and so on is Gaussian, so that's the other assumption over here, we have normally distributed noise and so on. Under these two assumptions, we can solve the Bayes filter in closed form. So these are so specific as a system which have like a name, which is, you know, the system satisfying this linearity assumption and Gaussian noise are called linear Gaussian system. And as I said, these are particularly lucky because in this case, the Bayes filter will emit a closed form solution. The closed form solution is known as the Kalman filter. It's Kalman filter essentially tells a couple of things. First of all, like if you assume linear system with Gaussian noise, the prediction update step of the Bayes filter will keep producing Gaussian distribution. So the distribution will remain Gaussian forever. And Kalman essentially also provides closed form expression for these messy integrals and for this. In particular, I will just you know, throw the expression here without, you don't need to really read, but the basic message is that Gaussian distribution can be parameterized by a mean and a covariance, and the Kalman filter is telling you how the mean and the covariance of the distribution evolve depending on the measurements that you have. So that is true for the prediction step and for the update step. And the nice thing, again, you don't really need to look at the math, but the nice thing is that Kalman filter essentially says that you can estimate the mean and the covariance of this distribution by doing very basic matrix manipulation. So there is just linear algebra involved here. It's very, very simple. So, okay, cool. We have like a nice, we have a nice tool for solving the Bayes filter in the linear Gaussian case. The problem is that in SLAM and in several other problems in robotics, the models that we really have, like motion and measurements, are nonlinear. For example, I was plotting like a measurement model in the case you measure distances or you measure bearing. You can see that these are like, you know, square root, Eytan function, and so on. So these are typically nonlinear. So the basic idea behind the extended Kalman filter is a simple one. If you have nonlinear dynamics, like this, we started with, the extended Kalman filter says, just approximate around some estimate, the current estimate that you have, the nonlinear model with linearized one. You can do just a Taylor expansion and get linearized one. And after you get the linearized model, you can apply the Kalman filter to that. It's like, you know, as simple as it gets. You have a nonlinear system, you linearize, and you apply tools which are typical of linear systems. Of course, while the Kalman filter was exactly the solution of the Bayes filter in the linear case, in the nonlinear case, it's an approximation. Because if you are passing this Gaussian through nonlinear function you're integrating, you will not get a Gaussian. So you will keep approximating the posterior. So we have a general tool now to perform estimation of a state of the system given, like, you know, our motion model, our measurement model, fits exactly in the input data that I wrote before about SLAM. So we can apply pretty much, it's a straightforward application. We can just apply this to SLAM to get our estimate of the state. And the result is this. Let me comment a little bit on this video. So what you should see in this video is that the robot, which is this guy with some orientation, which you can see from the mark here, is navigating in an environment with several landmarks. These landmarks are shown in green, and these are unknown to the robot. So the robot starts without knowing anything. When the robot starts going, it's trying to estimate, you will see this ellipsoid. So it's observing landmarks, and it's trying to estimate ellipsoids to each landmark. The ellipsoids are just a visualization of a Gaussian distribution in very high dimension. So the ellipsoid corresponds to the Gaussian distribution that the extended Kalman filter is estimating over time. Again, at every single step, the robot is applying prediction and update of this Kalman filter, extended Kalman filter, and as a result is estimating this Gaussian distribution parameterized by a mean vector and by a covariance. The mean vector will define, let me go back. The mean vector will define where the robot believes the landmarks are, which in general should be different from the true position. And the covariance is estimating these ellipsoids. So the covariance is telling how uncertain is the robot about the position of the landmarks. One thing that is pretty typical in SLAM is that as the robot goes and then comes back to places observed at the very beginning, like, you know, this landmark, for example, there is a consistent reduction, let's see. There is a consistent reduction of the uncertainty. So you see that these will shrink more and more as the robot goes around. So this is what is called loop closure. In other terms, if you are doing SLAM, the revisiting of known places will lead to an uncertainty reduction in your estimate, which is known as loop closure. So this is a toy example that you can see of like a 2D problem with these nice landmarks and so on. It's clearly a simulation. The truth is that this kind of approach has been like very popular since the very beginning, like, you know, when it was stated in 1990, and was at the basis of very compelling applications like MonoSLAM, which is a very popular vision-based SLAM algorithm by Andrew Davison. So this is around 2004. So what's happening here is that there is no robot really, but there is just the camera moving around. And the camera is detecting these landmarks, which in this case are not really like, you know, anything semantic, are just points in the image. And by tracking these landmarks over time, essentially the SLAM system is able to do to reconstruct the position of these landmarks as well as the trajectory of the camera. Let's see if I can. Okay. Here we go. So you should start seeing that the SLAM system is estimating the really see well, but I think these are the landmarks that are estimating, and you're estimating also the trajectory of the camera, the pose of the camera over time, okay? So these are the ellipsoid that you saw also in the 2D case in the previous example. It's pretty much identical to the toy example that I was giving, and this, again, at every single time is applicating the extended Kalman filter to estimate the mean and the covariance of your SLAM system, of your SLAM estimate, which is including both the pose, the 3D pose in this case of the camera, and the position of landmarks. Fantastic question. Fantastic question. So in this case, they assume they have some prior information on the motion. So for example, you can assume that the system is moving at constant speed. You know, you really don't measure anything about the odometer, you just assume that. More recent approaches are using the IMU for the prediction step. In this case, no. But really, like, modern approaches of these are using the IMU and integrate the acceleration and the rotation to propagate, and then they update using the visual measurements. You cannot apply visual odometry because otherwise you will count twice the information, right? You will count in the prediction and the update. So this approach, EKF-based LAMP, has been like, you know, I was showing example from, was stated in the 90s, showing example from 2004. The truth is that it's very popular right now. It's like very popular approach. It's like an open source library, which is called MapLab from ETH. This is work from last year. And you can see that, just let me restart the video, you can see that also visually, the philosophy is very similar to the Monos LAMP approach in which you're extracting, I hope. Yeah, you're extracting landmarks from the environment, and you're reconstructing these maps, estimating both essentially the trajectory over time of the robot and the position of the 3D landmarks. So what are the limitations? We said that, you know, EKF's LAMP, very first approach proposed to solve SLAM, quite simple in the sense that, you know, once we figure out the math of the Bayes filter and we learn about the Kalman filter, we realize that we can just apply Kalman filter to SLAM to solve it. What are the limitations? First of all, in the nonlinear case, which is the case you care about in robotics, you apply this linearization step. And for very nonlinear system, the linearization step will not work well. So what typically, what you typically observe is that if you have systems which are very nonlinear with a lot of noise, the EKF will tend to diverge, meaning that your trajectory estimate from the EKF will drift over time from the actual pose of the robot. Your colleague was commenting about unimodality. It's clearly a limitation. You know, committing to a Gaussian distribution means that, you know, we are committed to unimodal, to a very specific unimodal distribution. Some concern about scalability, not too much of a big deal, but by staring at the math in the Kalman filter, you realize that there are matrix manipulation, multiplication, and so on, and the complexity will go quadratically in the number of landmarks that you have in the state. Consider that typically you have like thousands of landmarks, this is not ideal. So this naive implementation of this is something that, that, you know, would not work well in practice. Finally, another comment from things that you guys were observing before. So I said that, you know, in the process of doing like a SLAM, you have to do data association, so you have to associate measurements to previous landmarks that you observe, landmarks that you have in your database, which is called data association. And of course, if you have the data association wrong, the EKF SLAM will fail catastrophically. So your estimate will just not make any sense. So that's another limitation and something to be very careful about in practice. So I will touch, after like, you know, this popular EKF, what happened is that in particular because of the concern of the unimodality, in the early 2000s, another approach started gaining popularity. Which is the particle filter-based SLAM. I will not really touch on this. I will just give you, like, you know, a video with like two-word summary of what particle filter-based SLAM is, and then I will move to the most recent algorithm used for SLAM. So, particle filter-based SLAM. The very basic idea is that you sample. You, rather than estimating a single trajectory, as in the EKF SLAM, you try to sample potential trajectories of the robot, which you can see here as different like black lines. You can see there are multiple potential trajectories. So you sample potential trajectory of the robots and you try to look at the trajectory which explain the best the sensor data. That's like very hand-wavy argument, but the basic idea of this is that you try to keep multiple hypotheses about the trajectory of the robot to estimate them up. And in this case, the method is directly estimating like an occupancy grid map of the MIT Infinite Corridor. That's like an example with 2D laser. So, as I said, I will not go into the math of this, but I want to comment on the nice thing about this is that it's good that you understand why some approaches have been like proposed early and they are still very popular, and some approaches are not popular anymore. So, okay, that was me. All right. So. What made the particle filter SLAM popular was, first of all, the fact that by sampling different hypotheses about the trajectory, you can keep very multimodal distribution, okay? One nice thing is that really you do not have to commit to data association. The particle filter somehow will figure out the data association on its own. And the other nice thing is that you don't necessarily rely on landmarks, but you can reconstruct directly occupancy grid map. So in the early 2000s, this was like, you know, a breakthrough. People really like this approach. and for several years was probably like, you know, the most popular SAM approach. The bad aspects are pretty intuitive. You are sampling trajectories from a space, and the higher dimension of the space, typically the more samples you need to kind of like model distribution in higher dimensional space. So most of the application of particle filter-based LAM are in 2D, because already if you start moving to 3D problems, you have to start sampling more and more trajectory. At some point, the computational cost of doing that is not convenient anymore. So indeed, as limitation here are mentioning particle depletion, which is the case in which your set of trajectory hypotheses are not enough, good enough to cover essentially the actual trajectory of the robot, and the trade-off between like number of particles and computational cost. The reason why I was putting like this nice video over there is that although particle filter-based SLAM said that it's quite rare to see right now, there are very successful examples in which essentially has been used in recent years. So this is the driverless car from ETH, just won the best student paper award at TICRA. And this is using particle filter-based SLAM to map this course of obstacles, and then to essentially run as fast as possible through the track. Okay, takeaway message about this is very simple. Although some techniques lost popularity over time, in some specific domain or application, they can still be good choices. For example, particle filter-based SLAM can be an excellent choice if you are moving like in 2D and if you are very unsure about the data association. Instead, since recently, like most of the work was focusing on 3D problem, we moved to different approaches, and that's why this lost popularity.
Why does it not depend
on the intuition behind that is the following. You have different samples of the trajectory, and imagine that it's like you're doing mapping from given trajectory for each sample. So each trajectory, you assume that you know everything about the trajectory, and this will make easy to fix the data association because you assume that you know exactly the pose. Okay? And then the fact that you sample multiple trajectory will automatically generate multiple hypotheses about data association. Okay, so let me move to the last SLAM approach I'm going to talk about today, which is probably the most popular SLAM approach right now. It's something that for which the historical evolution was pretty weird, in the sense that the approach was proposed in 1997, very early years, so even before the particle filter-based SLAM. But the truth is that in those years, was not practical from a computational standpoint. Just an early implementation of this approach was too slow for practical problems. So here there is this point in which people started realizing more and more, first of all, like the hardware improved, and second, also people figured out how to speed up the computation in this approach to make it practical and scalable to very large problem, and that really like caused a peak in the popularity of this approach. Right now it's like, I would say after 2007, 2008 became like pretty much the go-to approach for SLAM. So this is called map estimation. The confusing thing is that here map is not the map that we talked so far about. It's not the mapping problem. It's an acronym from maximum a posteriori estimation. So it's like an estimation technique. Again, you know, map estimation is maximum a posteriori estimation. It's a general tool for estimation. So, you know, the nice thing here is that we started with a general tool for estimation, which is the Bayes filter, and right now we're touching on a different general tool for estimation. And the other nice thing is that this approach has a long history in different communities, and has also been known under different names. For example, in robotics, like a while back, we're referring as maximum posterior estimation in terms of factor graph optimization or full smoothing. In computer vision, this is also called bundle adjustment. So as history, like in different scientific communities. Very popular approach, just to tell you like how popular this is, these techniques are at the basis of Google Street View. So, you know, 3D reconstruction that you get in Google Street View. And it's also at the basis of Google Cartographer, which is a recent tool for SLAM released by Google. Okay, let's try to look at the intuition about maximum posterior estimation. What I want to do here is to give a very, very simple intuition about how the approach looks like, and then I want to give like a probabilistic justification that is grounding the approach a little bit more on the theory side. So the basic intuition is that if you look, consider a landmark-based SLAM, which you want to estimate pose of the robot and landmarks in the environment. We said that we have the measurement model, and the measurement model, the motion model, and the motion model will be noise in general, but assume for a moment that the noise is not too large. In the case in which the noise is not too large, essentially the state, the propagation of the state will be close to the one predicted by the odometry. And this means that the difference between these two values should be close to zero. Similarly, if you look at the exteroceptive measurement at the measurement model, if the measurement noise is not too large, we expect the left-hand side to be close to the right-hand side, and we expect the difference between these two to be close to zero. So this suggests a very easy approach to estimate both the X and the landmark position by solving an optimization problem in which we try to look for the trajectory of the robot from time zero to time k and the set of landmarks that make as small as possible the mismatch between the mismatch on the motion model and on the measurement model. So again, what I said in the previous slide is that we expect this to be close to zero, and we expect this to be close to zero. Here, the optimization problem is just trying to look for a state that makes these residual errors as small as possible. So there are several differences with respect to what we said before. First of all, in the state that we estimated before, the SLAM state that we were using in the previous in DKF SLAM was the robot state and then the landmarks. So in the SLAM state, we just included the most recent pose of the robot. In this framework, we include all the past poses from time zero to the current time. So all the trajectory of the robot and all the landmarks are included in this large optimization problem. And indeed, we optimize over the motion model for each step and over all the measurements from the beginning of time to now. So this is a very large optimization problem. Let me give you an example. So we have an example with one landmark. This that I show is the ground truth trajectory of the robot, and the one in the middle is the ground truth position of a single landmark, just in these two examples. And what we want to do in map estimation is really like to take all the measurements from the beginning of time to the current time, both the proprioceptive measurements and the exteroceptive measurements, and get a map estimate, like a maximum a posteriori estimate of the trajectory and the landmark positions. Assume that, you know, the exteroceptive measurements are, for example, these measurements of the position of the landmark at different times. So this is, for example, we said that if you just look at the odometry, the odometric estimate will diverge over time, okay? So this is the expression of the result of just integrating the odometry of the robot. Of course, the odometric estimate will explain very well the proprioceptive measurements that you have, but will not explain well the measurements of the landmarks that you have. So in terms of the optimization problem, the fact that you are not able to express well the measurements of the landmarks means that you're optimizing a problem, but you are not really reaching the minimum of the cost function. So let me take a step back, because otherwise it's tough to get. So I'm saying that the maximum posterior estimation can be found by minimizing this optimization problem. The optimization problem looks for the state that is maximum agreement with the motion model and with the measurement model. Okay? And I said in the previous, you know, at the beginning of the presentation, that the odometry is in complete agreement with the motion model because it's just obtained by integrating the motion model. So what happens is that the odometric estimate will make this term equal to zero because we just literally obtained by propagating these to the next time step, but will not explain very well this term. In fact, you can see that visually the landmark observation are not in agreement with the estimate of the landmark. So this means that we do not have, by just using the odometric estimate, we do not have like a very good minimum of this cost function. We have a suboptimal solution. And if you minimize with maximum posteriori estimation, you find a better compromise between like the motion model and the measurement model, and you get a trajectory estimate and a landmark estimate, which is in better agreement with the ground truth. Questions? Was a bit fast on this side. Yeah, it's a bit easier to deal with, but again, here we assume that a given measurement is produced by a given landmark, so we assume data association. But there are a bit nicer ways to mitigate the data association problem. So yeah, that's a good point. There are a couple of answers. First of all, like, I'm trying to simplify a lot here. The truth is that these cells are typically weighted by some variance of the measurements, or the inverse of the variance of the measurement. So you have like some non-coefficients in front of the terms telling you that you have to weight less unreliable or noisy measurements and to weight more measurements that you expect to be good. The uncertainty aspect is not visible here, but it's still there. And indeed, I will explain that this has a very nice probabilistic justification in a couple of slides. Okay.
Yeah. And is this generally a non-complex optimization problem?
That's another excellent point. I will touch on that. That's one of the main challenges. There is recent work trying to solve that, like through convex relaxation and things like that. But in general, it's a very non-convex problem. Perceptualizing, for those of you who don't know about that, is essentially the phenomenon in which you have different places with similar appearance. So, for example, you can see that this room maybe is very close to the room nearby in terms of like how it looks like. And the main issue for that is that will trick data association. So we led you to think that a given landmark corresponds to that room instead of this one. So essentially, we create a problem in the data association. As I said, this association is typically a challenge for that. You have to look at robust estimators to mitigate that. But it goes back to the question of the association, I would say. Okay, so let me go fast here. Besides the interpretation in terms of an optimization problem, map estimation can be understood as what is called a factor graph. That's mainly like a visualization tool. So you can interpret, imagine that this is the trajectory of the robot and these are the position of landmarks. A factor graph is a graphical model in which the nodes are the variables that you want to estimate. So literally like the pose of the robot and the position of landmarks. And the edges represent measurements that you have. So for example, like there is an edge connecting this pose to these landmarks, meaning that from that pose you observed that landmark. And there are small edges connecting two consecutive poses, which is the odometric information. So again, edges in this graph represent measurements, and nodes represent variables that you want to estimate. Not super crucial. This actually is, if you design SLAM algorithms, this graphical structure has a lot of implication. But for the sake of today, I think it's just like, you know, fine to think about that as a visualization tool. Here, we arrive to the probabilistic justification that I was mentioning before. Turns out that maximum posterior estimation has a very nice probabilistic justification, which is different, very different from the Bayes filter. So the Bayes filter tries to propagate the posterior distribution, which is what you believe about the SLAM state, given the measurements from time k minus 1 to time k. Instead, in maximum posterior estimation, what do you do is that you take measurements, proprioceptive and exteroceptive, for all the time, from the first time like to the current time. And the maximum posterior estimator can be shown to be the peak of the probability distribution. In other words, the Bayes filter is really trying to reconstruct this weird probability distribution. Map estimation essentially says, I give up on that because it's too complicated. I just want to get the highest point of this distribution. And you can show mathematically that if you build the optimization problem in a clever way, the optimization problem produces the peak. Okay? And again, this is the peak of the posterior distribution over the trajectory of the robot and the position of the landmark, given all the measurements that you have till that time. So, very popular approach, you know, a very easy visualization. Let me start with an easy visualization. You have the robot moving, and it's incremental, essentially building this factor graph in which you keep adding poses for along the trajectory, and you keep observing new landmarks. Again, the nodes here are things that you're estimating while you go, and the ages instead are the measurements that you have. So at each time here, you're solving again and again this optimization problem. The optimization problem is producing the maximum likelihood estimate, which is the most likely, the peak of this distribution is the most likely explanation of your trajectory and the position of landmarks. You can see that the trajectory which culminates in this pose is our estimate for the pose. Instead, the ground truth trajectory is a little bit different. So the ground truth trajectory is the other pose here. Actually, the one in front is the ground truth and the other one is our estimate. And similarly for the landmark, there is the dark circle here, which is our estimate, and the green circle is the ground truth. So this is a very boring video, but I want to get to the point here. It's a very long. So also in this case, let's see. Also in this case, there is the phenomenon of the loop closure, which occurs when essentially you travel in the environment and you go back and revisit some of the initial landmarks that is at the beginning. You can see that while right now the ground truth is very far from the estimate of the pose, the more we observe, the more the ground truth the estimate should approach the ground truth. Let's see if it's true. So you see that right now I'm starting to observe again like all landmarks and apply this correction. So right now, like when I solve the optimization problem, I get an estimate which is much better, and eventually I get you should get like close to that one. Yep. Yeah, these are called incremental approaches in which you try to, in incremental approaches, since you keep solving like an augmented problem, you try to reuse some computation from the previous step to speed up the problem. One thing that I want to mention, these are very large problems, but the optimization problem has been studied so much that you're able to solve very large scale problems in seconds here. So I will show you like a little bit about that. Did it converge? Yeah, okay. So you see that the more I observe, the more my estimate gets better and converges to the ground truth eventually. So this was a toy visualization. Truth is that this is used for like, you know, large scale 3D reconstruction, you know, as I mentioned, like Google Street View and so on. We'll not have time to talk about that too much, but there is a variant of the problem in which you just don't estimate landmarks in the environment, you just estimate the pose, the trajectory of the robot. This variant is called pose graph optimization, and you know, that's a visualization, but I will not touch that. And the nice thing I was mentioning about scalability is that
at the first statement of the problem in 1997, as I said,
computation was a problem. Very naive way to solve this optimization problem is too slow, even if you have like 10 poses, okay?
There was a huge amount of understanding on how to apply optimization tools and how to leverage things that are specific to SLAM to solve this optimization problem very efficiently. And right now you can you know, download a state-of-the-art tool and you realize that you can solve problems with millions of like states, millions of poses in a matter of seconds. Okay, since I'm running out of time, so if you're interested in using these, you know, there are very nice implementation online. There are libraries which are more like focusing on the optimization problem that you solve in maximum posteriori based SLAM. Libraries like G2O, Georgia Tech, GTSAM, Ceres from Google, And there are also solutions which are plug and play, which you just have to connect the code to a camera and an IMU, for example, and you can get like a 3D reconstruction of the environment. Very popular SLAM implementation is OrbSLAM. There is also like some tool from Google, Google Cartographer. And as I said, like Google is using this technology also for Google Street View. So it's an example in which you do, yeah. So there is a version of the SLAM with the IMU, but before getting there, in principle, you can solve this optimization. If you have enough camera measurements, you can solve this optimization problem even without the first term. So you have a term with the proprioceptive measurements and a term with the exteroceptive measurements. If you have like the right type of exteroceptive measurements, you can forget about the first one, and optimizing over the exteroceptive measurements will produce still a good estimate. And that's indeed what is done in bundle adjustment. In bundle adjustment, you just have camera measurements, you optimize, you get the trajectory of the robot. The other answer is about, you know, again, using priors, about constant motion of the robot, things like that. This one? Yeah, so G2O, GT7, CLS are optimization libraries, which are taught, you know, for robotics, but essentially they are optimization libraries to solve maximum posterior estimation problems. So the first three are general optimization libraries, and these put essentially the sensor parsing on top of the optimization. So, but they're all using maximum posterior estimation. OrbSLAM is using PostGraph optimization, which is something that I mentioned before. Cartographer is also using like optimization-based SLAM. No, you have, in the optimization problem, you have this sum over the proprioceptive measurements and this sum over the exteroceptive measurements, right? And nobody's saying that all the measurements that you have should be like the same model or even the same like sensor. So you can put an index here, H, I, J, you can have a different model for each measurement. Okay, guys, I will, so I will clearly like will not have time to touch on visual inertial navigation. I want to mention that visual inertial navigation is actually a variant of SLAM, which has been like very, very popular over the last, I would say, like 5 or 10 years. And you will find the slides. You can go back and take a look at the slides and reach out to me if you have questions. The basic idea is that why SLAM is taught for to use all sensors and to optimize in the maximum posterior framework is to optimize the entire trajectory of the robot. In visual inertial navigation, typically you just use cameras and IMU, so that's why visual inertial, and you just estimate like a small portion of the trajectory. That's like a small technical detail. The actual goal here is that while in SLAM, the latency, so the time it takes to solve this optimization problem, is in the order of hundreds of milliseconds. The difference is that in visual inertial navigation, you want to get super efficient, super fast computation. So you're going to get real latency in the order of 20, 30 milliseconds. Okay, so that's why like this triggered a lot of interest and a lot of research, because there are several applications for which having this latency is very nice. Example of application is that whenever you want to close the loop over like a control of a fast vehicle, essentially the latency of your visual state estimate should be very fast, otherwise you're not able to control the robot at this speed. There are other applications like augmented reality and virtual reality in which if you have too much latency, if your estimate of the camera motion is too slow, essentially the user will get nausea. So, you know, you're not able to use that if you have like huge latency. Another application in which you need to have like fast estimates. Because of this large amount of application, of course, you know, there's been like a lot of interest. I will not go through these and so on, but there has been a lot of research. And right now there are commercial products, including visual inertial navigation capabilities, including like tools for augmented and virtual reality, like Oculus Rift and Microsoft HoloLens, Google Tango Tablet,
we did recently an implementation on a small chip of visual inertial navigation, other implementation for Qualcomm, so there are plenty of commercial products including this type of technology. So let me finish, you know, the visual inertia was just, you know, just a brief overview. You will realize that formulation-wise, there is not a huge difference with respect to SLAM, but the application is kind of different, like, you know, speed versus accuracy. Let me finish with a few ideas about, you know, open problems. One open problem that I will spend literally like 5 slides on that. One open problem that kept resurfacing is the problem of data association. Okay, if you have like wrong data association, most of these techniques we are talking about will break. More in general, the notion of data association can be taught in terms of the presence of outliers. So outliers are measurements that do not follow your model. Clearly, if I have a model, you know, h of xr, k, li, and instead I'm measuring lj, the model will not be like, you know, useful, right? So that will be an outlier. So if you solve like a maximum posterior estimation and you still fit, you still include some outliers in this cost function that you optimize, typically the estimate will be completely wrong. So this is a trajectory reconstruction for the case in which you do not have outliers or you have few outliers. This is the case in which you start having more and more outliers, which are shown in red, and eventually, you know, the reconstruction of the map and the trajectory will be completely wrong. If you think that this is an academic problem, this is not. Actually, it's a very practical problem. You can even see that you know, there are specific instances of Google Street View in which there are huge distortion of the maps. These are caused either by wrong convergence of the, you know, non-convexing and wrong convergence of the optimization, or most likely by outliers. And Google has a huge amount of people just to detect these issues and fix them. Outliers, of course, like, you know, another assumption that we packed pretty much in every approach that we presented so far is that all the landmarks are static. If you're moving in a crowded environment and you are detecting, for example, visual features, it's very likely that, you know, some of the feature will be a moving portion of the environment. And in that case, if you're not careful, you know, the SLAM estimate will not make sense because the static assumption will not be valid. This is the point that your colleague was mentioning about non-convexity. We're solving this optimization problem. We said, you know, this is the state of the art and so on. Most of these optimization problems that you find in SLAM are non-convex. And what it means for being non-convex is that you have like multiple local minima. This is like a 1D visualization of the problem. The problem is like 1,000 dimensional. Okay, that's just a toy visualization. What happens here is that if you're trying to estimate the trajectory of the robot by using like this optimization-based SLAM, if you get to the global minimum of this cost function, you get a nice trajectory estimate. This is a trajectory estimate in a parking garage with multiple floors. If you get stuck in a local minima, you get completely wrong trajectory reconstruction, and this means that your map will be a mess again, okay? So it's very important to understand a little bit about the optimization part, because if you're naive about the optimization, you're likely to get a very wrong estimate of the trajectory on the map. We have progress in that line. You can look at the references a little bit. I want just to give you like a basic message about this slide. Most of the approaches that we have been mentioning estimate this landmark-based map or like a point cloud-based map. So this is like a very popular approach, which is LSD-SLAM, I believe, or some variant. And you can see that the camera is moving around in the environment and estimating these point clouds. So typically, you get millions of points in this point cloud, so very large map representation. In my understanding, this is very different from the way humans think about maps. So for humans, we really understand the high-level geometry of the environment. We understand planes and so on. And we do that to compress information. Rather than storing 1 million points in a plane, I just have like, you know, a plane representation, which is very compact. Okay. We really have to make a lot of progress to get to high-level understanding of the geometry in SLAM. And the other big issue is about resource constraints and miniaturization. So in the work I did in the previous year, we talked a lot about how to miniaturize these perception capabilities on smaller and smaller platforms. And clearly, there is a bottleneck here in terms of like, you know, efficiency, power consumption, and so on.
if you compare the state of the art right now in machine perception and machine vision with respect to human vision, you realize something that is pretty incredible to me. The data stream through the human eyes is compatible to the data stream through a stereo camera. If you look at the performance, however, there is a huge gap. So humans are able to parse a scene in 13 milliseconds. Instead, like state-of-the-art in SLAM or like, you know, object detection is much slower than that. Even more so, the power consumption of the entire human brain, not just the spatial perception part, is overall around 20 watts. Instead, modern approaches for object detection, for example, are looking at 200, you know, are looking at GPUs and very powerful, you know, GPUs with hundreds of watts consumption. Okay, let me finish with this slide. Spatial perception to me is a very cool problem. So if you're interested in theory, you will find plenty of like interesting theoretical problem dealing with geometry, estimation, probability, optimization. If you're looking at, if you're interested in the implementation side of it, there is a huge space to do like very fast, very like good implementation, robust implementation. And if you care about implementation, there is a huge potential for practical impact. Long list of application from like, you know, domestic robotics, self-driving cars, planetary exploration, disaster response, augmented reality, people with disabilities, support for people with disabilities, education, huge amount of application. So please, you know, take, pay attention to spatial perception, reach out to me if you're interested in learning more. I'm putting like a few references here. Probabilistic robotics is probably the Bible of like this problem. It's a little bit of an, you know, it's 2005, so it's a little bit of an old reference, but it's a classical one and very easy to understand. This is a survey from 2006, which is also like a good way to start learning about this problem. And this is a very recent survey we wrote in which we have like a description of the state of the art, and we also have a description of the open problems, you know, in more details than what I told you today. So we'll stop here. Thanks. So if you guys have questions, otherwise it's lunchtime.
Okay, so we've had a little bit of schedule slip, but we're going to meet back here at 1:10, which will give you about 45 minutes for lunch.
And there's two things to note for lunch. So you'll want to explore, right? But you probably don't want to explore this time around. So if you go down to the first floor, right, then there's a cafeteria.